if the natural mechanisms are capable of explaining this, then let's just go with that, even though God certainly could have been working in interesting sort of selective ways along the way. But, you know, we live in a pluralistic world. Scientists have many different worldviews. We got to interact with those scientists. Therefore, we'll assume that God accomplished that just through natural mechanisms. Yeah, maybe that's a bias. It's a bias I've inherited from a whole tradition of thinking of Christian scientists over the last 300, 400 years.
So what's the that Jesus had an earthly father? I mean, you know.
Okay. And here's what I always think about that one. I understand, and then Brian, then you're next. I understand people who would just as soon kind of sweep miracles under the rug, and the virgin birth would be one of them. And here's my thought. If you accept the incarnation, that is, just think about the incarnation, okay? God, human. If you're willing to accept that, the virgin birth is nothing, okay? Healing miracles, walking on the water, exactly. Okay, so I see, since there's so much theological tradition going all the way back to the very earliest church on the virgin birth, I don't see any reason to throw that one out. Because on the other hand, if you have a trouble with the virgin birth, then I'm going to ask you if you have a trouble with the incarnation. If you have trouble with the incarnation, then we have something else to talk about. Okay.
To make a long story short, I mean, suppose the theologians who used the Reformed hermeneutic came to the conclusion that the creation of humans was somewhat more analogous to the virgin birth of Jesus than it was to something else, then how would one approach squaring that whole business, let's say, with the fossil record or genetic history or that sort of thing? And I don't want to jump to a conclusion on this. I just say that needs to be on the table as well here if we're going to have an all things considered conversation about this.
Yep. Yep. I agree.
You know, there's a flip side to that, though. So if we're going to raise the virgin birth as the sort of miracle that, you know, we need, then so you're saying, what's the probability Jesus was conceived by a natural father? I would turn the question around and say, if you assume he was not, what is your prediction if we find some of his DNA? What is your prediction? He was a male, and we all know what that means, that he had a Y chromosome, that he could not possibly have gotten from his mother. What's the prediction? It's not a test, and you don't need to pass it. But if we're going to play that game, it's going to go the other way. And I think that's a question someone should be challenged to answer as well. What does Jesus's Y chromosome look like? Or did he have one? I would never want to try to answer that question. But if you could traffic back and forth, there's your next question.
All right, so this,
I don't see why it tips it one way. I mean, it's another conversation, right, we need to have. I mean,
and
how did the water become wine? There was no carbon in water.
Right.
It's the same question.
So
miracles are either possible or they're not.
Right.
Now, which ones does Scripture require us to believe? That's the question.
Right. So that's okay. So one of the things I wanted to accomplish here was a list of questions to discuss more, and we've got a few. So Brian.
I'm now already being too late to fix my wife at 5.
You're assuming natural explanation.
Oh, no, I mean, because there could be a quantum mechanical event.
That's true.
Anyway, I apologize for keeping you.
Just another scientific issue to put on the table with theological import for human origins is exobiology. The fact that just 20 and a half light years away, we apparently have the possibility of a rocky body which is within a habitable zone of the star, which theoretically, through physical laws, chemical laws throughout the cosmos and cosmic time, could have the potential that life could evolve on. Now, if that's just 20 and a half light years away from our star, in a galaxy that's 100,000 light years in diameter, and there are several billions, if not trillions, of galaxies, then how do we think about the uniqueness, not only of life on Earth, but the uniqueness of human life intelligence, human life beings, in the cosmos, given cosmic history, cosmic time, and the possible common placeness of habitable planets that are conducive to life.
Indeed, I have read theologians who say there can only be one planet because the incarnation could only happen once. And I've heard all the theologians say there must be intelligent life out there because, of course, that's the way God would do it. And then among that, there are some who say, but still the incarnation is unique, and others who say, no, God would relate in some really interesting way, perhaps something like the incarnation, perhaps something different, with every intelligent... Anyway, great question. I don't know whether that'll help us with human origins or not. Maybe it will. Yes, there's a question here. Yes.
Okay. So my friends and I have heard this debate over the past couple weeks from the creationist side. And the first thing they attack is the validity of scientific dating techniques. So can you defend those?
Yes. Read this. Then go talk to Ralph Sterley and read his book. But I'll just put it this way. Those things are double-checked so many ways. First of all, geologists were utterly convinced by a dozen different lines of evidence that the Earth was hundreds of millions or billions of years old long before radioactive dating. Okay? So there's a dozen lines of evidence independent of radioactive dating. What radioactive dating did was come along and make those measurements more precise and double-check them and reinforce them, and then they started double-checking each other so that in some rocks they've been dated with two or three pairs of radioactive isotopes, different radioactive isotopes, and got the same number. So, yeah, you can't really poke holes in radioactive dating, and even if you could, it wouldn't help. Now that's a glib answer, and I speak much more carefully, and Ralph Sterley speaks much, much more carefully in his book. But in particular, I highly recommend learning what those other dozen methods of long ages. I mean, just for example, find a glacier, start digging down and seeing annual layers of snowfall just like tree rings, and count down 100,000 of them. Okay? That doesn't need radioactive dating. Things like that. So, good question. Thank you. And then here, and then here. Yes?
So in the Doctrine of Original Sin, it says social learning is the second transmission, but most, I'm the extreme learning theorist in psychology, are actually, believers in the tabula rasa, the blank slate. So he presented that as the opposite of original sin, so how are those compatible?
Okay. Yeah, that's a good question. You're getting into... You are using the terms more precisely than I was using because of your training in psychology. Yeah, tabula rasa for human beings is flat out, okay? Wonderfully disproved. But there's still a lot of social learning. So you can have, human babies hardwired for all sorts of things, and there's this ton of social learning. Now, the idea of... When I said tabula rasa, I guess... I should have used a more precise term. Some early church theologians were proposing a natural innocence to babies, that there is no taint of sin in babies, and the only reason they start sinning is because they learn it from us. Okay. Now, you don't need a tabula rasa for that. But, okay, good. Good question. Thank you. Yes, Scott.
Well, I was just going to jump on the question before that real quickly in terms of, from the creationist, the younger creationist side. I think one thing that needs to be part of the conversation. One thing to say to people who doubt radiometric dating or who doubt how we calculate how far a star is away from Earth, and I think one of the things to point out is that certainly even as Christians and so forth, I mean, we have to be consistent, we have to be logical, we have to be coherent, and I think a lot of people, when they doubt the methodologies by which we arrive at some of these conclusions, that star's 2 million light years away, this rock's 3 million years old, what they don't always realize is that they're doubting some of the same scientific methodology that has yielded things like DVD players and MRI scans. Nobody, you can go to most any church and find out that Mildred Smith's MRI scan revealed a ruptured disc, she's having surgery next week. Nobody says, no, she doesn't. who can trust that atheistic science, right? Milton just should go home and be quiet, and let's not play DVDs in church anymore either, because, you know, that's quantum physics. And, so, I mean, there's some real inconsistency going on. I mean, for radiometric dating and for the calculus of, you know, how distant stars, how far they are away, for that all to be wrong, a whole lot else is going to have to be wrong in the world, too. And I think that's an important thing to point out. Christians can be really, really illogically inconsistent on this, and that doesn't help any. Doesn't help the debate at all.
Mm-hmm. And thank you. Something that the two of you said just helped me think of a better answer to John Cooper, who's not here anymore.
I'll bring it back.
But I'll share it with you, which is appearance of age. Okay. The idea that God made the world recently but made it look like it had this long history. You know, people play with this idea for a while and wind up rejecting it, including young Earth creationists. They almost all reject it. Okay, so then I guess my answer to John Cooper would be the wonderful question he was raising. If something looks like it can be explained, something in the history of the development of human beings looks like it can be explained by natural processes, God accomplishing by natural processes, but we propose that, for theological reasons, that God also added other spiritual or transformational miraculous processes along the way, but it looks like it can be explained all by natural processes plus, you know, divine revelation, but without the need for a sort of miraculous transformation. If we propose adding miraculous transformations, are we doing some milder version of appearance of age? I wonder. Probably not. That's probably not fair, but that's one thing I want to put out there. Steve and then Dan.
Just a quick comment that about 2,000 years ago, you could have gone to a place called Cana and had some really good wine, and that was clearly the appearance of age. And you would not have been able to detect it. Like, you would taste it and say, I think this is fake wine. Instead, the leader of the party says, this is great stuff.
But if you performed a genetic analysis on the DNA in that wine, would you have found a local vineyard?
I think so, but who knows?
Okay. All right. Good. Dan.
Just to piggyback on your comment to John Lefkowitz, someone suggested that maybe concordism isn't the right framework for talking about this. I wonder if the distinction natural and supernatural ultimately is a bad distinction. Here's why. If God, as our creator and sustainer, is at every moment actively upholding the universe in existence, if he is the primary cause of all that is, and if he enables every life form to exercise the secondary causality property, he is so radically transcendent that he is also radically inner. And what we call natural processes are supernatural because God created the whole show.
Can I hear an amen?
Amen.
Is that not a creature?
But I still need another way to classify the difference between Jesus walking on land and Jesus walking on water. Okay? And I agree natural, supernatural is not the right distinction. But that kind of distinction between the difference between Jesus walking on land and Jesus walking on water, I think there is a distinction there, and an important one, not only theologically, but also... You know, for the purposes of our understanding how the natural world works, I think that distinction, whatever we call it, is part of what we're talking about in human world. Do we need something like walking on water in early human origins for theological reasons, or don't we? That, I think, is a question we're going to be debating.
We should read Dennis Edwards' new book on divine action, because he talks about miracles and different ways of understanding.
Yeah. Okay, Dennis Edwards' Divine Action. Good. I'm ready for another hand to go up, or I'm ready for everybody to just leave. Either one is fine. All right.
Good job.
Thank you.
Yeah. I made a bunch of notes. I'll email it to you. Just